2/I, Introduction to Realistic Philosophy. Third degree of life, the proper of man, is the spiritual life, which is composed in two faculties. First, an intelligence that is able to go beyond the realm of the material and the concrete, to potentially reach, all that is, not only the material but also the spiritual things, as for example, the understanding of what is a friendship, beyond feeling. The second faculty is called the will. The will is a love, coming from that intelligence. I explain quickly, the human being is the only being who sometimes, unfortunately not often enough, is able to love beyond feelings. We are able to love while we do not feel. It's not cuddling, it's not doing memes like that. It's simply, when we have an enemy for example, sometimes we want him well. It means that we do not want his misfortune, but we want him to change, to improve, and perhaps one day to re-establish himself in the world. In any case, that's what the judges are doing now with respect to prisoners. They feel that they must be punished and that their reintegration must be sought. Well, this is a spiritual love, a love of intelligence that judges that one can improve their moral life. The judges have no feelings for the prisoners. They want them well. They do not want a punishment, they want them to eventually reintegrate. Sometimes they want it too much. Because there are some prisoners who never re-enter. Like the big pervert sex criminals. This is naivety, it's something else. Man is the only one who can do it. The animal, as for example the faithful dog, loves only because it is carried by a feeling corresponding to his instinct. His masters become packs. Out in the wild, a dog, a wolf, will give his life for his pack. It's natural. If by chance an animal felt no more feeling for its master, well, he would leave. He cannot love without feeling. This is what the philosophy of the living will learn. It will also manifest that this being who has three degrees of life, is unified, it is one living person. The philosopher will discover that this unity is due to a unique principle of life. He will structure all this to form a single living thing, and this principle of life is called the soul. We will study in this discipline, each of the vital faculties, its functioning, its object, its laws. In short, we will know, as best as possible, how a human being is alive. Well, I say that this second discipline, called philosophy of the living, and that Father Marie-Dominique Philippe also develops in his courses that were filmed before his death, it is essential for someone who wants to do theology. It must be trained in the best possible way. Not only to know the life of Christ, his humanity, his passions, but also to know our neighbor and to better help him. There is a third part of the speculative philosophy called physics. She studies inert matter, matter as it exists. Well, I would say that part of it is less useful for someone who wants to do theology. She is interesting. Someone who does philosophy has to do it. But someone whose goal is theology, which is centered first on the human being, therefore something alive, has less interest in doing it. So if I summarize, in the speculative parts of philosophy, it is essential to do metaphysics and the philosophy of life. Philosophy does not stop there. It also has three parts called practice. It means that we will study the man, with a view to action, with a view to concrete action. In the three practical parts, we observe that there are three essential activities in our life. The one that takes the most time but is less important is called the work. I think it's less important to study philosophy, which is called the philosophy of work, when you want to do theology. It is interesting, it allows to understand the Christian art, to understand the liturgy, but it is second, despite everything, if we are in a hurry or if we want to go to the essential, because the liturgy is the song biblical, it is more important to know the heart of the church, which is charity. That is why the second part of practical philosophy, which is studied in philosophy and which is called moral philosophy and which has a relationship with our neighbor, with the people around us and no longer just with a work of art. Art, like the philosophy of work, is essential to study. The moral philosophy studies many things like, for example, the human acts, as I said it like it is that the love, the intention of life, the choice, etc. It studies the virtues which make it possible to better to pose these human acts. Virtue of prudence, virtue of temperance, strength, and justice. These are the four classic cardinal virtues of Aristotle. This part is essential because all moral theology is simply the study of a moral act of love of friendship towards God which leads us to love the neighbor in the same way. So the more one forms in this moral philosophy, the easier it will be to understand moral theology which is structured in the same way because grace follows nature. Third part of practical philosophy, it is called politics. So she not only studies the fabricated work, as in the philosophy of work, she does not study it in relation to one person with another as in the moral philosophy that is called in Latin, agira, it study the relationship that we can have in a community, around a common good that structures this community. So she will integrate a part of work, moral parts, because there is a lot of friendship in a community, and more superficial parts like for example simple relations of civility with people with whom we do not have friendships, but with whom we collaborate to form communities. This part is also less important, even if someone wants to push very far, theology, he will need to understand what is the church, this particular theology that developed the Second Vatican Council. Because in fact, the community of men, at the philosophical level and the supernatural community of the church have a structure that is similar. In both cases they are communities. The human community is structured around the common good that is called, the good to live, and the Christian community, the church is structured around the common good which is called charity, namely God and His love and the neighbor who is loved by charity. So if I summarize, in the practical parts of philosophy, whoever wants to become a theologian must first study moral philosophy. This is what matters most. It remains a seventh part of the philosophy that St. Thomas called natural theology. Indeed, if we look at the six parts that I have just developed, we realize that we say absolutely everything about man. Nothing can escape him. For example, if I study a notion like death, I can study it in metaphysics because I'm going to watch what it breaks. It breaks my being because it removes some of it. It will be necessary to ask if the spiritual part, the thought, has a certain survival, when the body itself decomposes. Second, it can be studied in the philosophy of the living, because death comes to destroy my biological life, and one will wonder in philosophy if it comes to destroy also my sensitive life, and if it comes to destroy my soul, and my spiritual life. Aristotle will actually show that for him, it can be shown that the spirit and the soul necessarily survive the death of the body, because they have no material object. They are not made of body. When I study something like death, I can also study it in physics, for example, and it's less interesting. We'll be able to study the decomposition of the corpse. So we see that it is a secondary subject. Did I say everything about death, when I analyzed according to these three parts of philosophy? Not at all. I have to study it also in ethics, because it breaks the relationship with those I love. I have to study it in politics, because it comes to destroy the community and there is the funeral that comes to restructure as a patch, this community that was injured by one of its members. I can even study it in philosophy of art, if only by the funereal art and the sacred art that is put on the tombs to indicate a hope. What I see is that in these six parts of philosophy that have studied death I miss something profound, ultimate, and that is what will constitute the seventh part of philosophy. The part that was also at the origin of the birth of philosophy in men of the Paleolithic. It is called wisdom and it is she who asks what is done on earth and whether there is survival after death. Is there a creator behind all this? These are really philosophical questions. But this discipline will only be part of philosophy on one condition, that it has demonstrated its answer. If, for example, in this discipline that I call natural theology, I have demonstrated that there is necessarily a creator and that the soul survives after death, I can truly call it natural theology. If, on the other hand, it happens that I show that there is no creator and that all that is material and that the soul is simply an effect of the neurons which are a little structured, then I could not more to call it natural theology since there is no theo, theos which means God, I would call it, metaphysics of the meaning of life, materialistic metaphysics, materialistic philosophy of the meaning of life. I would find any name and I would develop and there, one of the great atheism which developed in the 14th century. In any case, in both cases, and whatever answer I would give, which is my answer to me and that it can be shown that there is a creator, that is really part of philosophy. Well, there is something there that needs to be studied by the one who wants to do Christian theology. Indeed, the Church has always said in its dogmas and she repeated it at the Vatican Council I, that it was possible for man, by his reason alone, that means in philosophy, to demonstrate the existence of a first being who created the world but also to demonstrate the survival of the soul after death. Well, the minimum, since the Church says here that it must be done, is to do it and therefore to be interested in this discipline. So if I summarize, someone who wants to train in philosophy must, and it is essential to do metaphysics to understand what it is that the person of Christ and the human person, he must make the philosophy of living to understand what it is that living human nature with its degrees of life, with its unity with its diversity of faculty, it must make ethics to understand what is the love of friendship and virtues, which will enable him to understand the moral theology which is a love of friendship with God and finally, he must do natural theology in order to be intelligent and not just to believe that God exists but to know rationally that God exists. The other disciplines of philosophy, therefore physics, which studies inert matter, are very interesting. The political philosophy that studies the human community is also very interesting. The philosophy of the work that studies the work, either in its beauty or in its utilitarian nature, is very interesting and there for someone who wants to really deepen, it is only then that we can do it. For someone who is in a hurry and wants to go straight to the point, it may be a secondary matter. Rest. This weird part called criticism. It is not a matter of criticizing, it is criticism, it means a critical study that analyzes the certainty and fragility of our philosophical knowledge. Well, I think we can always do it, if only to keep this humility of the philosopher who knows that the real, it will escape forever, and that I would say, like the Father Marie-Dominique Philippe, that it is not truly a part of philosophy. We do it every time we do philosophy. We look exactly what we say, it's certainty, we doubt when we have not really demonstrated what we said, we try to improve as more and more what we say. So this is it. I hope that this lesson for future theologians will have been useful, and I insist that we can find, by writing to the community of St. John, or I will put it on the internet, we can find the best school of this realistic philosophy in Father Marie-Dominique Philippe. It is he who I think was the instigator of the revival of realistic theology at a time when there was more in the seminars than presentations of systems, all contradictory and often ideological. Many disciples followed him and liked to train at his school, and I think that very quickly these courses, which are currently very expensive, will be put on the internet for these four essential subjects anyway, that I take again: metaphysics, philosophy of the living, ethics, and natural theology. Introduction to Realist Philosophy, Lesson 3. In this series of courses that aims to make metaphysics realistically, I would like to introduce what philosophy is all about through a little history of philosophy. It is impossible, of course, in such small cassettes to give a total history of philosophy, but at least we can get to have an overview that allows us to understand how human thought has structured around philosophy. In the course of 50,000 years, no doubt, or nearly so, of its existence. First, the word philosophy is a Greek word meaning, in Greek, love, sophilia, love of wisdom, sophia, wisdom. Wisdom in the beginning is not a science, such as physics or chemistry. Wisdom is the science of science that every man, when he comes to earth, asks himself the answer to the three fundamental questions: where do I come from? Where do I come from, obviously? It's not about answering I'm from my parents. Where do I come from, basically? Am I coming from chance? Do I come from a creator? And who is this creator? Second question, who am I? It is not a question of answering immediately by saying to myself I am composed of 80% of water. No. Who am I radically? Am I just a passing steamer who will disappear? Or am I a person, called to eternity? Finally, the third question, where am I going? Is there life after death? Will I find everyone I love? Or is there nothing after death? Am I going back to dust, as I came? So this discipline that we call philosophy took the name of these three questions, and that for a very simple reason is that at the starting point, the men did not ask themselves what it was Adam. What men have asked themselves when they appeared on earth and intelligence has emerged are precisely these three questions. Once we understand, what is this name of philosophy, and we can easily establish four great ages of philosophy in the history of humanity. Four great sages, who, moreover, sometimes overlap each other. When was philosophy born? When did the man ask himself questions? Well, we can say that as soon as man is a man, it means that as soon as he has a spiritual life, he is not simply limited to natural things like survival, reproduction, he asks himself these questions necessarily. It's still valid now. There are sometimes some individuals who never ask the three questions I just mentioned, but they are extremely rare. We should find a man who throughout his life has always been allergic to it and lived like a beast in everyday life, in the snapshot. It can happen to us in moments of our life, but sooner or later we are caught, if only because we have children and a child can be lost. If only because old age can reach us and that there are necessarily questions. I believe that the finest, the most mystical people, ask themselves these questions from childhood or at least, from the beginning of adolescence, and often the mark of these questions, it is the anguish. Because in today's world where there are no solutions, where we refuse to give an answer, and well, young people, at this level, wander and seek, or do not seek and choke in the activities, the pleasures to precisely not ask these three questions. They will come back to the source because the man is structured like that. So it was not otherwise at the very beginning of humanity. When was philosophy born? Personally, I think she was born with Homo sapiens sapiens, that is to say with us. I am not at all sure she was born with the Neanderthal man, although some paleontologists say the opposite. They say the opposite because they found some examples of graves that are organized, with the idea of survival. That is to say that there is a little pollen, we find traces as if there had been flowers on the body, and that on the other hand there is sometimes a hinged beak, next of the body, which means that one wanted to give him food for the afterlife. However, I have a doubt. Why? Because we find some examples of tombs actually, but always when the men of Neanderthal lived with us, Homo sapiens. It is therefore very difficult to conclude with some examples that they buried their own dead. Similarly, if in 20,000 years found the dog cemetery of Panton, we cannot conclude that dogs, in the 21st century, buried their dead. So there may be other explanations. I am quite open to the fact that the Neanderthals have had a spiritual life and therefore have asked themselves these questions of wisdom. But I'm still waiting for some truly organized graves to be found, even though there were no Homo sapiens in the area. The presence of the spirit can be defined from the paleontological point of view when two kinds of traces are found. These are not the technical tools, such as the fact of making a spear with a tip or handle the fire, that can indicate that we have enough faculties to ask these questions. Indeed, chimpanzees make some tools. They can use a pebble to defend themselves. They use small pieces of wood to get termites in the holes and feast. The utilitarian tool, it has as its object something immediate, survival, sometimes reproduction, and therefore animals do it. On the other hand, what is characteristic of a spirit that has gone beyond the immediate side of the material is when one finds traces of graves organized with the idea of survival, and, on the other hand, when one finds the fine arts, decorative arts, which, moreover, at the very beginning of humanity, are sacred arts, that is to say, ordered to the idea that there is a survival. Instinctively also paleontologists, when they find the caves of Lascaux, they did not have the idea that one had represented animals because it was beautiful. They immediately had the idea that they had been represented because there was an animist cult, that is to say, it was considered that by offering them an honor, hunting would be better, survival would be better, and in fact there was something religious, related to the animal spirits that had been killed in the hunt. It may be a true intuition, it may be a false intuition, we will never know, since the men in question have disappeared. What is certain is that when Homo sapiens sapiens appears, not the archaic Homo sapiens, there were hominids who had a body very close to ours and who had never buried their dead. They behaved, and we see it in their encampments, like animals, from every point of view. But when Homo sapiens sapiens arrives, that is to say, the modern species, the Cro-Magnon man, at once what is striking are the graves. The graves are systematic, the honor given to the dead is systematic. That shows that there was the question of survival, and that if there was the question of survival that goes beyond the individual death of the corpse, the animals are sensitive to the death of an individual of their family. A monkey mother, when her child dies in her arms, she will keep him in his arms for a long time. She is attached to it. It is only when the body is going to decompose, that the smell will be unbearable, that it will eventually let go. She will let go of him in pain. So she has feelings of pain. This is not a proof of spirit. The chimpanzee mother does not ask the question of survival of her little chimpanzee on the other side. The obvious, external trace that there was a thought that went beyond this simple feeling was that the little one could have been buried, and that the mother could have put some food in the idea that he was going to survive in his hole. This is what modern men do as soon as they exist. So we can assume, we can even insert, that from the external effects that philosophy, in the deep sense of the term, in the sense of philosophia, love of wisdom or knowledge, it was born as soon as the man is man, Homo sapiens sapiens. So obviously, the responses of the time are a first age that will be called the age of childhood philosophy. It's exactly what kids do when they're young. They believe in stories, they need answers, but they believe, they trust their parents. And if we tell them that Santa Claus exists, they trust their parents. If these children still kept their grandchild mentality, well, they would tell their own children that Santa Claus is coming, that he is the one bringing the gifts, and so on. Only they grow up. Well, for humanity it's the same. There was a first age when men gave themselves responses of the order of the tale, but they needed those answers. They repeated them from generation to generation in trust. So they trusted, they had faith in their parents, who gave them a tradition that explained their presence on earth. What is very interesting is that in studying the civilizations that currently exist in the 21st century still a little bit on Earth, we find, without doubt, all the answers that were heard during these very old ages. Why? Because there are still peoples living as in the Paleolithic. Paleolithic is the age of the old stone. This is the age when there were a lot of herds on Earth, where there was no need to farm the fields. We still find today civilizations that live as in the Neolithic. Neolithic is the age of the new stone, stones cut with more precision, more beauty, more finesse. It basically corresponds to the time when the large herds had disappeared, the game had become more rare, and laboriously began to invent agriculture and livestock. When we look at current civilizations, those that remain and still exist in those ages, we find, both in the depths of Siberia, and in the depths of the Amazon, roughly the same answers. So in this age of philosophy's childhood, when men lived as children, they believed in things, we consider that there are three great traditions. The first and the oldest, that of the Paleolithic, is when the answer to the three questions of wisdom was the animist response. I think it's probably the oldest of religions, the oldest of the wisdoms that existed on earth. Animism, very frequently, believes that there is a great single mind that governs the whole earth. This is a curious thing and quite amazing and weird, but we can notice. Why? Because the rest of the answer her, she is logical and consistent with the lifestyle that these men had. It must be considered that at the time, it was as if we had released, in a hostile world, children aged 14, 15, who had never had a culture. They were confronted with giant animals that could sometimes kill them, kill the children they made themselves, or kill them on the hunt. If these children, these young people and without culture had to respond to their presence on Earth, they would have immediately imagined the following: they were themselves animals, animals, and the animals in question were respectable and were perhaps they themselves are gods, on a par with themselves. If one went hunting, the biggest fear the woman could have was that her husband would not come back, killed by prey that he had tried to catch to feed his family. So, as the fear was about that, about the absence of the game too, and well, logically the religions of the time became animist. That is to say, we began to systematically thank the animals, when they gave us the grace, to give their lives to feed us. They were thought to deserve a thank you, a prayer was given to them, sometimes a small sacrifice was offered to them. In fact, it was considered that if this sacrifice was not made, the animal's angry spirit might come to warn the rest of the flock, and that the next time there would be a dead hunt or we would not find the flock and we would know famine. So the animist makes sense, as do caves like Lascaux, where we offer a sort of cathedral for those animals that are used for hunting, or those who are dangerous to honor them. But it's coherent that this child thought. In short, the answer is related to his own life. In this animist religion, which is the first wisdom, where do we come from? But probably the great spirit of nature. This is a religion that we certainly find, biblically, in the story of Noah with the rainbow symbolizing the peace that God promises but also the sacrifices that we make to God in question. Who are we? Well, we are an animal among other animals and we must respect the order of nature. Are we surviving after death? Yes, no doubt, but like animals. That is to say, we believe much in this period, the spirits of the dead, the ghosts that can come to haunt us, if we do not offer them a serious burial. In the same way that we offer a certain honor to the animals we killed on the hunt. So human spirit, animal spirit, we do not really see the difference at that time. Where are we going after death? Some have a conception of a paradise for the one who has been right. But other religions, already, are afraid of death. They consider death as a wandering stay, where one is a shadow, sometimes malevolent, that annoys the living.